morning, everybody. We're so happy to have you here on this beautiful February morning. We have a lot of visitors, and so we're happy that you are here with us as well. I want us this morning to continue a recurring theme that we started last month, where, if you recall, we studied the theme of blessed assurance, and after each point of the sermon, we were led by Greg in a stanza of the song, Blessed Assurance. In other words, we learned it, then we sang it, then we learned and we sang it. Etc. I want to have another go at that kind of idea this morning. But this morning, focusing our attention on the word holy or holiness. The word is one that has been greatly misunderstood in the world to the point where if you use the word in the correct way, people look at you as though you said something very strange. The fact is, if I say I am a Christian, therefore I am holy, or, to use another word that's misunderstood, if I'm a Christian, therefore I am a saint, people look at you and think that's a very arrogant person. They look at you and they think this person thinks very highly of himself. They may even think that he thinks, or that I think if I say it, that I'm above sin, or that I'm incapable of sinning because I say I'm holy, or that I say I am a saint. The fact is, the word has a special, specific meaning. It is not the meaning the word has been applied to it in the common usage of the word. It is used about 549 times in your Bible. 376 in the Old Testament, 173 in the New Testament. This is a Bible word. It has a Bible meaning, and its meaning is this: to be made different. That's the meaning of the word. Now, the word different implies we are become different from something. And in the case of Christians, Christians are made holy by God because we have been made to be different from the world. We have been made different from sinfulness, made to holiness. That doesn't mean that we're perfect. That doesn't mean that in times of weakness that we sometimes make mistakes and even sin. But that does mean that as Christians, the children of God, we are and are supposed to act differently. Now, I want you to look at for just a second, Ephesians 1, 3, and 4. You don't have to turn there if you don't want to. I'll just read it to you. It's just two verses. But it's Ephesians 1, 3 and 4, where Paul says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world." I've been chosen to be something. Something has been set aside for me from before there ever was a me, and that is that I should be holy. Now, be is an action word. It's something I have to do. I'm supposed to do holiness. I'm supposed to carry out the action of the verb, holiness. I have to be holy. He set aside me before the foundation of the world to be holy and without blame before him in love. That's another phrase or word, blameless, that's been misunderstood. Blameless has become this idea of perfection. He's blameless. But it just means that nobody can bring an accusation justifiably against you. Anybody can accuse you, but nobody should be able to justifiably accuse you. No one should see you doing something that they can bring accusation against you and cause you to be blamed. That doesn't mean you won't make mistakes from time to time, but your general character of life is supposed to be different. And so the verse that you have, I think, in the Sunday paper on your pew this morning, 1 Peter 1:15, "He that called you is holy, so you be holy in all manner of conversation," or in the way that you live your life. In other words, because God is God, and because God is holy, he made you to be godly. And thus, you should also be, and I should also be, holy. It's an action. So then, let's consider the question. If I'm supposed to be holy, I'm supposed to do holiness, I need to know what to do to be holy. I need to know how to be holy. So the question is, what do I have to do? How can I be holy? And the answer is, I have to take time to be holy. And how do we do that? Well, open your songbooks to number 731. We'll use our Bibles, but we'll also be singing, led by Brother Greg, periodically. Now, your songbook has, or my songbook now, has three verses. There's a fourth verse that we don't have, so I may accidentally call the wrong verse number, but you'll know about my reading. But you have there before you the song, Take Time to Be Holy, which is basically a sermon in and of itself of what a Christian is supposed to do, how a Christian is supposed to live, how a Christian is supposed to think in order to carry out the command, be holy. A holy person, number one, talks with God. Look at verse 1 of the song. Take time to be holy, speak unto thy Lord. Abide in him always and feed on his word. Talk is a two-way communication. I talk to him, he talks to me. A holy person talks with God. A holy person, number two, thinks like Christ. Philippians 2:5, we'll study in a moment. But look at verse 2 of the Psalm. By looking to Jesus, or abiding in Jesus, I think yours says, like Him thou shalt be. If I look to Jesus, if I abide in Jesus, then I will act like Jesus. That starts, first of all, with my thinking like Jesus. And then last, number 3, we'll notice. A holy person doesn't just talk with God or think like Jesus, but he also travels in the Spirit. Verse 3, be calm in thy soul. We'll skip down a little bit. Thus led by His Spirit to fountains of love, thou soon shalt be fitted for service above. A holy person takes time to be holy, and that means, number 1, we talk with God. Take time to be holy. Speak oft with thy Lord. Now, the Psalm, that first verse, has two different things I'm supposed to do. Speak oft with the Lord and abide in His Word. But they're just two sides of the same coin. They involve communication. Communication is not a lecture. Communication is not just me talking and you listening. Communication involves both of us giving and taking. I'm supposed to, first of all, speak often to God. That's prayer. Pray without ceasing, your Bible says. 1 Thessalonians 5:17. That's an amazing, short little verse. Pray without ceasing. Now, what does it mean to pray without ceasing? I'm sitting here right now preaching. You're hopefully listening. Neither one of us is praying. So are we disobeying that command? No, because the verse means have your mindset constantly in a state of prayer. What is your attitude? What is your demeanor? What is your thoughts like when you are praying? You're probably very, very reverential. You're probably very humble. You're thinking of spiritual things. Those kinds of attitudes and thoughts should be in your brain 24/7, not just when you pillow your head and say your evening prayer. But I heard the verse explained like this one time, and I've always repeated it. Pray without ceasing. Here's the best way to do that. You wake up in the morning, you say your morning prayer, but you don't say amen. Instead, you just open your eyes, you get up, you shower, you eat your breakfast. Before you head out to work, before you drive off, you say another prayer. But you don't say amen. You just keep on praying the prayer you started in the morning. You go to work. You work until lunchtime. You sit down before you eat. Hopefully you don't overeat. We said in class. You sit down before you eat, you continue your prayer. Then you thank God this time for the food, but you don't say amen. You go about the rest of your day. You go home. You do all the things you do before you pillow your head at night. You close your eyes. You say your prayer. And this time, finally, you say amen. And so you know what you've done. You have said one huge prayer throughout the whole day. There's nothing wrong with that. And I'll tell you what it does. It helps you keep your mind on prayerful things. It's much harder to say things you're not supposed to say or go places you're not supposed to go if you're currently talking with somebody who doesn't want you going or saying those things, right? I mean, you'll say things by temptation. You may say things with your coworkers or with your classmates at school that you may not say in the presence of your mother or your daddy. But if you're talking with that person, you probably won't say the things that you say or go the places you would go if you're just with your friends. And so have your mind always talking to God. It makes it a lot harder to sin that way. Pray without ceasing. Now, there are some very specific things your Bible says that you're supposed to pray for as holy people. And it's interesting to me that the very first time the word prayer is used in your New Testament, it is used concerning your enemies. Matthew 5:44. Jesus says, I say to you, pray for your enemies. He first says, love your enemies. Bless them that do bad to you. Bless them that hate you and despitefully use you. Pray for them which persecute you. Pray for them which are in the present now using and abusing you. He doesn't say pray for them who might one day. Now that's easy to do because I'll pray that they don't someday. But no, he says in the present right now while they're hurting you, pray for your enemies. Didn't Jesus do that? Luke 23:34, Father, forgive them the ones who nailed me, them the ones who are cursing me, them the ones who are blaspheming. They know not what they do. Holy people, pray for the lost. Matthew 9:37 and 38, Jesus said to his disciples, the harvest is plenteous. That means there's a lot of things to be plucked in the field. The laborers, though, are few. Excuse me. Pray, therefore, the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth reapers. Laborers, that is, into the harvest. What am I supposed to pray for? Before I ever go out and meet one soul, before I ever go out, I'm supposed to go out, but before I ever go out and talk to one person about the Lord, I have to pray for that person, that his heart will be opened, that his stubbornness will be melted, and that he will obey the gospel. Pray. Pray with feeling. Now, I'm hesitant to use that expression because that's another expression in religion that has been misused and misapplied. And so they say, well, as long as you have the right feeling, it doesn't matter what you do. Well, no, that's baloney. If that is what you do, God gave you a Bible to tell you what to do, how to live, and how to think. If that is what you do, but if that is what you do with the right feeling. If you're just doing the actions, but you don't have the right heart, you might as well not do the actions, because then you're just like the Pharisees, who got a lot of it right, but their attitude was wrong. And so Jesus says, Matthew 6:5, when you pray, do not pray like the hypocrites do. They love standing in the corners of the synagogues, and in the streets rather, so they may be seen of men. Verily I say to you, they have their reward. What's their reward? They're seen of men. They don't care who they're talking to, they care who hears them talking. And the result of their not praying with feeling is they're not being heard of God, or seen of God rather. Or they're not heard of God because they're just caring about being seen of men. The power of prayer is not just in the words uttered, the point is. It's in the feeling one applies to it, and having the right mindset and attitude. But one thing a holy person must do above all else is talk with God. And that means me talking to Him. That also means Him talking to me. Now, He doesn't whisper in my ear and tell me to do things. He talks to me through His Word. Feeds on His Word, like we sing in the song. I'm a Christian. Therefore, I'm supposed to feed on God's Word. Now, I have to have food to live, right? We had that nice discussion in class. You got to eat to live. Well, you have to eat to live as a Christian, don't you? You have to feed on God's Word. What will studying the Bible do for us? It will keep our paths right. Psalm 17:4. Concerning the works of thy lips, I have kept thee from the paths of the destroyer. If I study my Bible, it will keep my paths right. If I study my Bible, it will keep my paths bright. Psalm 119:107. Thy word is a lamp to my feet. It's a light to my path. How do I know where not to go, what not to do, where not to be? Because God has shined a light on the path. So I can see all the way from here to eternity. And I know where to go and where not to. The word, when I study it, can prick my heart. Acts 2:37. That means if my heart is meltable, if my heart wants to obey God and I hear the word and I know what to do, my heart will melt for God and it will obey Him, as it did there, Acts 2:37. But my heart is also scarable, Acts 5:33. When those people heard the word, they were, it says, cut, I mean seared, like with a hot iron. Makes it tough, makes it callous, makes it unfeeling. Now, if I really grasp that idea, it can be a very scary thing to open my Bible and start reading it. Because I know the Bible's going to tell me what God wants me to do with myself. And if I'm not willing to obey God, and if I reject the message, my heart will get a little more tough. And then the next time I read it, it'll get a little more tough. And then a little more tough, until eventually I have no feeling at all in my heart. Which is this, by the way, not this. I keep pointing here. I should point here. I have no feeling at all in my desire to obey Him, and so I just completely give up. And I never obey Him, because it has seared my heart. I'm supposed to, though, have an open line of dialogue with the Father. That means holy people talk with God. I talk to Him, and He talks to me. Now, we know it. Now let's sing. You have your songbooks there? Verse 1, please, Brother Greg. Take time to be holy. A holy person doesn't just, though, talk with God. A holy person also has to think like Christ. Take time to be holy, verse 2. The world rushes on. So spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus. That's the way I learned the song. I think your book says abiding in Jesus. Either one works. Like Him thou shalt be. That's the point. Thy friends in thy conduct, His likeness shall see. In other words, I should be living my life, doing the things that I do in the 21st century, so that you see a first century man's attitude and actions in my life. How so? Because I first think like Christ. Your Bible says, whatever a man thinks in his heart, so is he. How a man thinks in his heart determines his actions. This is not my heart. This is just this muscle that pumps blood through my shell of a body. My real who I am is my soul. My soul is connected to what I do with it. That's my intellect. This is my heart. Whatever a man thinks in his heart, so is that person. My thoughts control my actions. Because before I ever do anything, I think, am I going to do this? And I decide to do it. That's why it's so foolish to say that my body is evil, that my flesh is evil. There are some modern translations that say your flesh is evil. No, that's baloney. Your flesh is not evil. If you think your flesh is evil, cut off your arm and then insult it. If it jumps up and slaps you, then okay, your flesh is evil. But no, if you insult me, well, I'm not supposed to slap you, but go with me. Then I'll slap you. Why? Because I made the decision to react. I thought to do something, and so I acted on that thought. This is my heart. Whatever I think I am, so that I need to control my thoughts. Look at Philippians 2, and we'll see how to do that. Verse 5, starting. Now, we looked at this verse, but I think we just read it and moved on. Let's actually dig into it for just a little bit. Philippians 2, 5 through 11. I'm supposed to think like Christ. What does that mean? Well, Philippians 2, 5, Paul says, let this mind, that is, this mindset, this attitude be in you, the same which was in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not, the King James says, robbery, to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon himself the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, as, like a man, he wasn't fully because he never sinned, being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God has highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, whether in heaven or earth, things present, things to come. I probably mangled the end of that, but you get the point. All should bow before Jesus because of what he did for us. Now, that doesn't say, by the way, all will bow, but all should bow, whether in things heaven or things on earth, because of what he did for me. But what did he do for me? What was his mindset for me? When I read Philippians 2:5, it starts with Jesus in heaven, that is, as the second personification of God in heaven, who did not think it robbery. The word means he did not think it a thing to be selfishly held onto. He chose to leave heaven to come to earth. How hard must that have been? I'm going to do anything in my life to get to heaven, to leave earth to there. He chose, just like that, to leave there to come here. He thought it not a thing to be held onto, to come here. And he came here to become not some majestic king with a long flowing robe or all bowed before him, but instead he came here to be a servant. Humble like a servant, of no reputation like a servant. A servant even to the point of serving, if it meant his own death on the cross. Now that was his mindset. And everything you read in Philippians 2, 5 through 11, you can apply to your Christian life. Now you can't leave heaven, but you can find the attitude there. The attitude of humility, the attitude of self-sacrifice. Listen what your Bible says right there in that text if you're looking at it. It says, he became a man for you. What happens after he died, rose again, and went back to heaven? He remains a man for you. 1 Timothy 2:5. Yeah, 1 Timothy 2:5. We have one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus. That's now in the present. Him in heaven is the man, Christ Jesus. Now, you think about that. I think we have totally unappreciated what he did for us. He was 100% God in heaven. He chose to leave heaven to become the God-man. 100% God, 100% man. And after he died and went back to heaven, he remains to the present and into forever the God-man. He changed who he was, his very nature of being, to save me. Because he had to be a man to die for me. That is the ultimate in sacrifice for me. And so my mindset should be, I will sacrifice anything of me for him. Take time to be holy. By looking to Jesus, like him I will be. It starts with my thoughts. So that in my conduct, people can see his likeness. Jesus said, Matthew 20, 28, the Son of Man did not come to this world to be served, but to serve. And in serving, he says, he gives his life a ransom, as he paid the price for many. I have the same mindset, to become like him and be willing to die for him. So that at the end of my life, Luke 17, 10, I can say, I am but an unprofitable servant, having done just that which is my duty to do. We have to look to Jesus, abide in Jesus, and be like him. Now we know it. Brother Greg, lead us in verse 2, please. Let's sing it. I didn't realize until I was writing a sermon this week, and I was looking at the psalm, that each of the three verses gives you something about the Father, something about the Son, and something about the Spirit. And that makes perfect sense. And so it is a perfect symmetry to the sermon in that way too. Because a holy person first talks with God, he then thinks like Christ, and then he travels. So you have three T's, or walks. Travels in the Spirit. Thus led by his Spirit to fountains of love, thou soon shalt be fitted for service above. Now my walking in the Spirit means that I don't get to walk in my own path. I don't get to choose my own way. My son, Jack, is the older of the two. He's getting smart. He's getting too smart. He's getting the bad kind of smart. And we like to say to him, Jack, you need to go to your room and clean your room and then get ready for bed. And he'll say, well, I think I'm going to. Well, no, you don't get to I'm going to. There is no I'm going to. The I'm going to is whatever I said you're going to do because I'm the parent. So I say, go clean your room. Or if I'm eating and he's already finished, I say, leave the table because you're bothering your brother. Well, he's, well, I'll go play in the living room. No, I say go play in your room. There's no negotiation here. If I'm walking in the Spirit, I have to walk with the Spirit, and I don't get to say, well, I'll go my own way and find that way eventually. No, it doesn't work that way. I love studying Jonah. Isaiah is my favorite book in the Old Testament, but Jonah is my favorite person in the Old Testament. Here is God's reluctant prophet, Jonah 1:2. Jonah, go preach to the Ninevites. Jonah 1:3 says, and he goes this way and runs. And he runs until he doesn't have any more land to run, so he gets in a boat and swims away. I thought that's going to stop him. And so 3 days later, he comes out of the whale and realizes, I better go preach to the Ninevites. The moral of the story is, do what God says the first time, you won't get swallowed by a big giant fish. Now, probably the moral of the story is, God has a plan for you. If you study, if you look at Jonah, what it seems like God is trying to get me to understand is, God has a plan. Not necessarily a plan for me, but just in general, God has a plan. And I should be humble and thankful and grateful that He wants to include me to work in that plan. But I have to do things His way because He knows best. I tell my son to do something, it's because I know it's best. Even if he thinks he does, he typically does it because he's not old enough yet. Well, I don't know the mind of God, but God has this big plan, and I should be grateful that He wants to include me, imperfect, sometimes pathetic, little old me, in that plan. I just need to walk according to that plan, or I'll make things tougher for myself. So I'm a holy person. I talk with God. I'm a holy person. I think like Christ. I'm a holy person. I walk in the Spirit and nothing else. Brother Greg, lead us in verse 3, and then we'll have a conclusion. You hear how the song gives you my own ways of doing things. I have to let each thought and each motive. What is motive? That's the reason you have for doing things. See, that's where we get caught up in it. I think I should do this because I think. Now, there is no because I think. When you study your Bible, because I think should not be in your vocabulary. It should just be because God says. And that way, each thought and each motive is beneath and under His control. If you're here and you're not a Christian, it doesn't matter how good a life you have lived thus far. How good a husband or father, how good a mother or wife, how good a student or neighbor. It doesn't matter how good a moral person you have been. If you are not a Christian, saved by the blood of Christ, you are not by definition holy. But you can be. You can be. You, imperfect you. You, flawed you. You sometimes counter to the very nature of God, you can be made holy, sanctified, set apart by the blood of Christ. If you would only obey the one in whom you believe, be immersed into Him, R 16:16, that He will make you holy. And without holiness, no man can see God, Hebrews 12:14. And then you can be holy. And then you can live like holy people live. And then one day see your Maker forever and ever. If we can help you do that, if we can help you be restored to holiness, we want to. Please let us know how right now. Let's stand and sing.